Hello, everyone. I'm Stephen Hardy, editorial director and associate publisher of Lightwave, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to today's Lightwave webcast, in which we'll be looking at enabling 400G pluggable optical modules. Our webinar today is sponsored by Henkel Corporation, whom we thank for the help in making today's event possible. 400G, of course, represents the next evolutionary step in pluggable optical modules, particularly for data center applications. We've seen a few deployments this year, but the market is expected to ramp beginning next year. And that means if you're looking to get into the space, you have some decisions to make pretty quickly. In fact, I imagine some of you are already thinking about what your second generation of 400G might look like and where the market may move next. And so to help you with this process, it will be my pleasure to look at the current and future market landscape and provide you with some information about how you can address your opportunities with the help of Blake M. Wegman, Applications Engineer, Technical Customer Service at Henkel. I'll kick things off with a look at current technology and market trends and provide a peek at what may be on the horizon. Then Blake will discuss strategies for dealing with the thermal issues that 400G presents to your module designs. But before we get going with all that, let me take a moment to review our webcast setup for those of you here for the first time, or perhaps the first time in a long time. As you can see, your screen contains a few windows, which you can open, close, and move around as you'd like. I'll start with the Q&A submission window, which you should see next to the slide area. If you don't see it, try clicking on the purple Q&A icon at the bottom of your screen. I invite you to feel free to use this to ask questions of either of us at any time during the event today. To submit a question, just click in the box, type in your question, and hit the submission button. Blake and I will get to as many of your questions as we can after we both have finished our presentation, so at the end. As usual, we don't plan to reveal the names of anyone whose questions we answer today, so you'll be able to participate in the Q&A anonymously if that's important to you or to your company. Now, in the event you run into a technical problem, during the event today, you can call for help using the Q&A tool as well. Just describe your problem, hit the question submission button, and Shannon, who is today's webcast technician, will be happy to help you out. Next, if you know of someone who might benefit from seeing this webcast or you just want to revisit the presentations yourself, the webcast will be available on demand from our archive for the next 12 months. We'll send you an email with a link to the archive sometime in the next day or so that you should feel free to pass along to your coworkers who might be interested. And the archived version of the webcast will also be accessible from our website at www.lightwaveonline.com. Just look for the word webcast above the main navigation bar. Click on that. Find this webcast on the list that you'll be presented with. Click on the title, then click on the registration button, and you'll be in. Now, we will not be making a copy of today's slides available directly, but you will be able to ask for them. You can do that using the blue icon that you see at the bottom of your screen. That's the one that has an envelope on it. That'll pop up an email window that you can use, as I said, to ask for a copy of slides or to ask for some additional information or to follow up after the presentation. Speaking of additional information, if you click on the green event resources icon, you'll see some complimentary materials that you'll find useful as well. Just click on it and feel free to download it from there. Now, finally, if you'd like a certificate of attendance, perhaps for continuing education purposes, hang on until the end of the event, and I'll let you know how to get your hands on one. And with that, let's begin with a look at some of the major pluggable module trends that we're seeing. Of course, as is always the case, bandwidth demands are continuing to increase in the applications that we're talking about here in the data center. A lot of that is being driven by the increasing capabilities of switch chips and the IOs that they'll be requiring. So certainly 100G is well entrenched in the market, and as I mentioned earlier, we're starting to see some deployments of 400 gigabit Ethernet devices. Some of these actually there's a good chance that most of these are kind of custom devices, maybe some 2x200G, for example. But we're starting to see, or we'll soon start to see, some 400 gigabit Ethernet modules enabled via the single Lambda 100G technology, so 4x100G devices. And so certainly there are several companies that have already announced these, and we're expecting those to see some significant market take-ups starting next year. So with that going on, of course, it's kind of natural to ask what's going to happen next. As I kind of implied at the introduction, what we'll be seeing fielded next year are going to be first generation devices, and I mentioned those of you in the audience who are module vendors are probably already thinking about what the follow-up generation may look like. Meanwhile, there's obviously a lot of interest in what the next data rate might be. Certainly, there seems to be a consensus forming around 800G. There's the 800G MSA that's been formed. There's also a development going on by what used to be the 25 and 50 gigabit Ethernet group that has recently renamed themselves, and they're working on 800G as well. The IEEE is embarking on a call for interest for the next data rate that they'll take up as far as official IEEE standards to follow on for 400 gigabit Ethernet, and so it'll be interesting to see how that proceeds. That's being led by John D'Ambrosia, who's well known within the IEEE and Ethernet communities. I did an interview with him a few months ago, Yeah, you can find that on the Lightwave website, but he also was talking about energy and the potential for 1.2 terabits per second as well. Meanwhile, people have been wondering if there might be a future in alternatives for pluggable modules. Certainly, there have been several efforts in terms of onboard optics with the Consortium for Onboard Optics, or COBO. In the forefront of that, they have specifications out and available. We've also seen some proprietary devices displayed at trade shows and whatnot. The other big trend, of course, is co-packaged optics. There were scheduled to be some demonstrations of that at OFC earlier this year. Of course, because of the pandemic, that didn't come off as expected. But there's certainly a lot of work going on here. But even as that work proceeds, there looks like there's still going to be a long future for pluggable optics, even in light of things like co-packaged optics as well. So, obviously at these advanced rates, but certainly obviously in the near term for 400G as well. So along those lines, here's a look at what Light Counting expects to see over the next few years regarding the uptake of high-speed devices, particularly 400G. So as you can see here, looking at the market overall, there was something of a pause in 2019, as Light Counting put it. It's the first time Ethernet transceiver sales actually declined year on year in a very long time. We're expecting, despite the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic, to see at least a return to growth, or although, as you can see, obviously not quite to the levels of 2018, but things pick up pretty rapidly after that going forward, and we kind of resume the same kind of upward trend that we had been seeing previously. So as you can see, the graph here is divided between 100G and below and 200G and above. And as I mentioned, we're starting to see some deployments of 400 G or aggregate 400G modules this year, but next year is when we're really starting to see things pick up. So basically, as you can see, 200G and above, and a lot of that is indeed going to be 400G, is expected to account for at least half of the Ethernet transceiver shipments. and sales by 2023. The thought is that perhaps you know, greater than 400G might start reaching the marketplace by the 2025 timeframe. That's the end of this forecast period. But most if not all of the 200G and above that year is still going to be, I would think, 400G as well. So here's another viewpoint on what's going to be going on in the marketplace. This comes from Dell'Oro, which recently released a new Ethernet switch data center five-year forecast. As I mentioned, Google and Amazon are doing some initial deployments of 400G this year. And as I mentioned, that's not necessarily in the 4x100G format. There's been some a lot of reports about particularly Google using 2x200G. The thought is that Facebook and Microsoft will start moving towards 400G next year. And as I said, that's when we really start seeing things ramp, particularly for the 4x100G style devices. So the Dell'Oro is a little bit more optimistic about when 800G might take off than like Counting was. As you can see, they're looking at 2023 or 2024. But as was the case with 400G, that 800G could be a 2 by X format. Obviously here that would be 2 by 400G, or theoretically we will undoubtedly see some a move towards 8 by 100G as well. And so with that as a background, let's take a look at one of the major challenges for 400G pluggable module design, thermal management. As I mentioned, Blake Wegman is a thermal applications engineer with Henkel, where he is focused on thermal management solutions for the telecom and datacom sectors. Blake joined Henkel in 2013 as a lab technician and has since held roles in product development and technical customer service, where he currently provides in-depth customer consultation for leading telecom and datacom companies. During his time at Henkel, Blake has been a key member of the team supporting one-part liquid thermal interface materials, dispensing application optimization, and thermal stability and reliability. Blake holds a BS in bioproducts and biosystems engineering from the University of Minnesota and is based in Henkel's Chanhansen, Minnesota facility. Sorry about that. Blake, it's all yours.
Thank you, Stephen, for the introduction and the background for today's webinar, Enabling 400G with Micro Thermal Interface Materials for Pluggable Optical Modules. On behalf of Henkel and myself, I just want to say thank you for everyone who joined today. And really what we're going to be talking about is Henkel's new product line, the Micro TIM Durable Coating Interface Materials. So what topics we'll cover today, we're going to start with a little bit more background information on top of what Stephen presented already, kind of the industry trends that we see from Henkel's perspective and what thermal interface material solutions we can provide for those trends. We're going to be talking about 400G modules and micro-TIM durable coatings and why they fit together and why we think it's a great solution. We'll talk a little bit more in depth what are micro-TIM durable coatings, and also we are going to go over a little bit more technical topics today in terms of micro-TIM durable coating thermal performance improvements that you could expect with 400G modules, the effective pressure on the thermal improvement of the interface between optical modules and their heat sinks, and then we'll go into finally micro-TIM durable coating durability comparison to the incumbent solution that we see in the market currently. So kind of the two big industry trends in datacom, telecom industry or customers that we serve, what we see is really pushing the module switch to 400G is greater bandwidth and data processing capabilities, and then eventually as 5G deployment is launched, there'll be several applications that we can support with our thermal interface materials there as well. So in terms of data centers, really what we're looking to help our customers in terms of capability is rich media streaming and high definition 4K or 8K video, the increasing levels of cloud-based storage, and then also customers looking for a lot of throughput and power and data mining analytics and new machine learning applications. And then for 5G deployment, we think there's other opportunity there as well, although we will be focused on more datacom and server type applications. We will be looking to support in the future enhancing mobile broadband, definitely working with our customers and the module vendors to increase response time and latencies, and then also enabling AR and virtual reality applications as well as autonomous vehicles. So really today, how our MicroTin Durable Coating 1000 series approaches helping the greater bandwidth and data processing in data centers is really looking at hyperscale cloud scale transition to these 400G modules that Stephen introduced and trying to enable our customers to meet the greater bandwidth needs that they're going to be seeing in the future. And so we really see that there is room for an effective thermal management solution that is really needed at these 400G pluggable optical module interfaces in terms of cooling them efficiently. We see that we can help improve that process, especially when we're looking at modules that are running with power settings around 14, 15 watts and greater. So what we're doing now is introducing our new micro thermal interface coating, which what I said was the MicroTin 1000 series. It is essentially a thin, durable, heat dissipating solution for these high power modules. So a little more background on 400G module solutions. Why do we need it, and why do we think that MicroTin durable coatings are going to be a great solution for the problems of 400G modules? So starting on the left here, we have a graph of some of the legacy module form factors on the very left, and then moving to the more recent developments in technology, ending with quite a new popular form factor that we see with our customers in the QSFP style modules, and certainly the double density version of those modules. So you can see here, this is a graph of those form factors versus the module bandwidth density. So how much data transmission they're capable of when corrected for their size. So we're trying to look at these in terms of a comparable or apples to apples comparison for their size versus how much data transmission capability they have. And so what you can see here, the main point looking at the 400G red triangle form factors is that there's over time been an exponential increase in the density of bandwidth that you see using these different module form factors. And really what that means to someone like me who is trying to engineer thermal solutions is that higher bandwidth is higher power requirements, which means higher heat in that application. So our scene on the right is there's a definite need in the telecom datacom industry, like I said, for this super huge exponential traffic growth, faster data transfer, and larger bandwidth densities. And this really creates a problem where I think a lot of module vendors and our customers who use those modules are trying to come up with a more standard form factor and then keeping that form factor constant as we increase the power and bandwidth density of those form factors. So what this does is it's essentially with the same geometries, we're exponentially increasing the power and therefore the heat generation problem of these devices. So really Henkel's perspective is how do we dissipate higher and higher amounts of thermal energy in the same form factor or geometry? Well, really what we want to do with our MicroTim durable coatings is enable higher efficiency heat transfer at the module interface with the heatsink in these datacom server rack applications. So specifically at the line card, we're looking to enable these 400G and higher power bandwidth density modules by coating their riding heatsink with our MicroTim coating, which allows a lower thermal impedance between the POM and heatsink interface. And this is growing in importance and especially important for power dissipation in modules greater than 14 watts. The second factor of what we're looking at is we really want the module and heatsink interface to be protected, avoiding damage and wear and tear on these expensive modules. So we really wanted to form a solution that is not only thermally high efficiency in terms of heat transfer, but we want to maintain the durability of our solution and the durability of the module over time so it can maintain that high efficiency heat transfer across the lifetime of these modules. So we developed our solution in MicroTim durable coatings to have high abrasion resistance, and really what that means is they can withstand the abrasion force of plugging and pulling an optical module out of its application up to 500 times. So what are MicroTim durable coatings? Henkel produced this material technology solution. It's really both the material and the process that we use to apply the material for achieving thermal performance and durability at the module and heatsink interface. These materials are a silicone ceramic composite thermal interface material and is applied directly to the heatsink itself. So really what we're trying to achieve with this type of material is lower contact resistance at the interface of the module and the material, and then again the material and the heatsink. And then overall, what we're doing is taking that entire interface of contact and lowering the thermal impedance. So that's how we improve the efficiency of the heat transfer. So if you look at the cross-section drawing on the right here, we have a module that's essentially cut in half so that you can see the board and the heat generating devices, and then we have the riding heat sink on the top of that module, and then you can see our coating is a very thin layer that is between the two interface parts there and is highlighted as MicroTim durable coating with a red arrow. So it's quite a small form compared to the size of the heatsink in the module, but we really concentrate on the most important heat transfer surface between the heatsink and the module. So we do have some specific requirements for what type of heatsinks we can apply our MicroTim coating to. This would be both aluminum and copper heatsink designs, and they can be both monolithic and non-monolithic type heatsinks. We have specific solutions for the different types of metallic heatsinks and their chemical metal treatment process that they might have. So one of those would be for aluminum heatsinks. We have chemical conversion coating and electroless nickel plating types that we can coat onto. And then for copper heatsinks, we have a bright tin metallic coating finish, and again, electroless nickel plating that we can coat to. And really what we're doing with this coating is we're trying to concentrate on a very thin, thermally conductive, non-thermally resistive layer on the heatsink. It planarizes the heatsink surface, so it tries to improve the contact between the heatsink and the module itself. And the thickness of our material averages about 24 microns. So it's an incredibly thin planarizing layer, and what this really means is if you look at the second drawing on the bottom right, we have a MicroTim durable coating heatsink explaining the planarization for the thermal interface. So the top picture before coating, you can see the different color gradient corresponds to a different height of the surface of that heatsink. So blue is low spots and red is very high spots of the heatsink. And then so once we add our coating on the bottom, you can see that the coloration of the heatsink is a lot more uniform or a lot more standard across that surface. So that's one way not only are we improving the contact of that interface, but the material itself also increases the efficiency of heat transfer. So we're making the heat transfer better, and we're increasing the area, the surface area of that heat transfer for the module and the heatsink. I talked a little bit about our material being durable with greater than 500 module insertions and pulls in application. I'll go into that, and of course, the more important greater than 5 degrees C thermal improvement when compared to the incumbent metal to metal interface. So right now, a lot of the heat sinks that the data center applications are using are just a bare metal heat sink with nothing on them. And we always compare our performance improvement to that metal baseline as the incumbent solution. So what we see here is like you can achieve greater than 5 degrees C temperature decrease with our material, and that was measured with a module at 15 volts. So I want to go into a little bit more technical detail on the thermal improvement compared to the metal, the bare metal solution like I've talked about before. We typically call the bare metal M2M, which stands for metal to metal, so that's just describing the current interface that the POM heatsink experiences. So I'll be saying M2M or metal to metal, and I'm just referring to the incumbent solution right now. So what we're looking at in this graph is what we do is we take heatsink builds that are just the bare metal heatsink. This, in this case, it was a number of 50 heatsinks, and we measure the thermal performance of those individual parts and average the thermal resistance of those parts. So you can see that reflected here as the red box plot. And then what we do is we take those same 50 parts, we coat them with our thermal interface material, the MicroTim durable coating, and in the black we record our thermal resistance for the same heat sinks with our coating. And you can see that we overall, in terms of thermal resistance, we achieved an average drop in 0.33 degrees C per watt of that interface. So definitely a significant improvement with our coating. That average 0.33 degrees C is repeatable across surface treatment types and heat sink types. So whether they're aluminum, copper, non-monolithic, or monolithic, we typically see the performance improvement right around 0.33 degrees C per watt. And of course, this translates to a delta T improvement, also a 5 degrees C temperature decrease of that module at 15 watts. So that would just be 0.33 times 15 is about 5 degrees C. So it's important to note that in the future, as we move to even higher power 400G modules at 21 watts, so that would be a ZR type module, you will actually potentially see an even higher delta T with those higher power modules. And certainly moving into 800G, we expect similar and even better results as well. So I said that I would be talking about the effects of pressure on thermal improvement. We know that in a lot of designs in our customers and a lot of line cards and server racks, the design kind of dictates how much variation in pressure the interface between the module and the heatsink actually sees. So there is quite a big variation across different vendors, across different applications. And so we really wanted to test and understand what a low pressure scenario would look like versus something that's a little bit higher pressure. So what we did here is we did the same thermal testing where we take a number of uncoated parts and compare that to the same parts but then coated with our MicroTim durable coating. And so here we're sweeping from left to right on the x-axis from 2 psi to 12 psi. And then we have the same thermal resistance on the y-axis in degrees C per watt. So what we're looking at here is typically what we will see, like the average assembly pressure with a clip and a cage for modules, especially in the QSFP format, is about an average of 12 psi. So that's really where we've done the most work, and you see the same 0.3 degrees 0.33 degrees C per watt improvement versus that only metal interface. And what's interesting here is that that 0.33 degrees C improvement is pretty solid across changing the pressures all the way down to 2 psi in the low pressure interface. So I always see around 0.33 degrees C watt improvement over metal, but the absolute magnitude of your thermal performance or your delta T increase is going to be slightly dependent on that pressure. So even though for 2 psi, the improvement is less than, or the performance is less than at 12 psi, we still have the same performance improvement over metal to metal. So we think that brings a lot of value that you'll be able to achieve the same performance improvements at the module at low pressure versus metal versus high pressure at the same time. So I'll take a little bit of time to talk about durability and performance with 500 insertions and pulls. This is quite a lot of 500 or a lot of insertions and pulls for a heatsink or a module to experience. I think in application, the number is probably a lot less than that. For specifically the QSFP-DD MSA specification for the industry, I think the requirement is that a module has to survive 100. So we kind of went a little bit further than that, looking at what the thermal and durability capability of bare heatsinks and our coated material on those same heatsinks really is. So what we're looking at here, we have two different types of heatsinks. On the left, we have insertions and pulls performed on a bare aluminum, and then on the right, we have insertions and pulls performed the same way, but on a nickel-plated heatsink. So what you're looking at is six pictures. That's the same heatsink across 0 through 500. So at from moving left to right, we have 0, 10, 50, 100, 200, and 500 insertions and pulls. And you can see that because of the material, the wear pattern over 500 insertions and pulls is quite different, but it's extremely drastic in that you can see that the interface is very marred. The physical characteristics of the heatsink has changed over time. And so what this really translates to is by changing that surface, you're actually decreasing the efficiency of heat transfer between that heatsink and the module. So the rougher, less consistent that surface is, the lower the performance. And so when we actually test the thermal performance after performing these durability insertions and pulls, is we end up with these graphs below. So on the left and the right for both metal and, aluminum and nickel, we see that the red box plots of just the bare metal drastically decreases in performance. So the thermal resistance is increasing, which lowers the efficiency of heat transfer, whereas compared to the microtim durable coated samples in black, again, you can see that it's very consistent through 200 insertions and pulls, and then getting to 500, just a slight tick up. But again, a much more consistent, durable interface, and therefore more consistent, low thermal resistance for that interface with our coating applied. Now, really what we think this translates into is modules that are going to be running at higher bandwidth or higher data transmission rates for the lifetime of that module, and then also less replacement costs for both heat sinks and the modules themselves. As with our coating, they're not going to be marred really bad and damaged like we're seeing these heat sinks here. So investigating a large number of insertions and pulls was really important to us, but we also got a lot of feedback from customers that that's not the only important factor. So we also really wanted to look into the short term, like what happens with fewer insertions and pulls, maybe a little bit more relevant or realistic to the datacom or server rack applications, where a lot of times modules are plugged only a few times and they spend their lifetime of an individual module in the same port or near the same port for most of their lifetime. So we really wanted to investigate a lower number of insertions and pulls. So again, what we're looking here, on the left, we have some real images at about 50x, I believe. Of on the left top is the bare nickel heatsink, and then we have the same nickel heatsinks with our MicroTim durable coating just underneath that. So you can see that the heatsink goes from kind of a gray to a white, so the white is our coating material. And on the right, we have another example of our optical profilometer, where the color gradient is respective of the differing heights of the surface itself. And again, the bare nickel on the top and our coated heatsinks on the bottom. And what we can see here, moving from left to right, 0 to 5 insertions and pulls, we have those 6 pictures again. And what we're seeing is even at 1 to 2, 3, 5 insertions and pulls, you can see that the metal-to-metal contact between the palm or the module and the heatsink, they're kind of grinding on each other a little bit to the point where you're altering that surface. And we can see this bare metal heatsink has a pretty deep scratch forming in it. Whereas if you compare that just underneath the same insertions and pulls on our coated sample, you can see that there's really no effect. The coating remains intact. There's no scratching. There's no marring of that interface surface. And then that is also reflected in what we can measure in terms of how does that quantitatively change the surface characteristics of that heatsink. So looking at the surface profile in terms of height, you can see that same vertical white line scratch on our optical profilometer scans, and it shows up on the optical profilometer as a black line. Excuse me for a second there. So continuing with that, what that really means in black is that the scratch itself is so deep that it's beyond the 200 micron scanning range of our optical profilometer system. So basically what that means is we've gone from a color scale of 25 to 50 microns to describe that gradient to now over 200. So we are severely changing the surface in terms of the height variation across that bare metal surface. And then again, if you compare to the lower pictures, the more red ones with our consistent planarized coating surface, you can see that there's really no scratching effects on that material. So again, what does this mean in terms of performance for the modules and the application itself? What we see here on this graph is moving from left to right. On the x-axis, we have the 0 through 5 insertions and pulls, the thermal test data that we collected from the same pictures I've been discussing. Again, we're explaining the thermal performance results in terms of thermal resistance in degrees C per watt. And you can see at 0 insertions and pulls, we have that same metal versus MicroTim durable coating performance improvement of 0.33 degrees C per watt. So again, matches the expected performance improvement of our material. But then what you see with as little as 3 insertions and pulls for an uncoated heatsink, you're essentially marring that surface again and decreasing the efficiency of heat transfer. So the metal interface can't handle that surface marring, and essentially what happens is it increases our performance improvement of the scratched surface to 0.87 degrees C per watt. So that's over just with 3 insertions and pulls of the module and application. We're seeing a performance improvement of over 2.5 times the initial increase. So we thought that this was really, really important to show not only the thermal value that our product brings immediately, but the continued thermal improvement over time that our product brings in terms of durability. So just to summarize everything I talked about today in terms of MicroTim durable coating solution and how we enable 400G, is we see in the market the adoption of 400G modules, and a lot of these are going to be the QSFP form factor that run at greater than 14 watts. It's a really small form factor with high power density, which creates a large heat dissipation challenge. We've looked at the incumbent heatsink to module interface, and we think that there's room for improvement over that metal-to-metal interface. where we think that the thermal interface resistance is significant and only becomes more of a barrier for data transmission and thermal performance of modules as time goes on and you raise the number of insertions and pulls. So we thought that this was a great application, a great candidate for a thermal interface material. And really the challenge here was to create a scalable, modular, durable insertion and pull resistant thermal interface material. And our solution that we're promoting for these applications is the Bergquist Microtin MTIM 1000 series. Like I said, it's a very thin, durable, heat dissipated coating, can survive greater than 500 module insertions and pulls, which far exceeds the QSFP MSA requirements. And what we see in terms of quantitative test data is that we average 0.33 degrees C watt improvement performance across surface treatment types when compared to the incumbent metal interface solution currently on the market. And what that means is it really translates into 5 degrees C temperature improvement or 5 degrees C reduction of the POM operating temperature at 15 watts. And of course, as we're moving into 400G modules that are greater than 15 watts at 21 watts of the VR type modules, we're going to see higher delta T improvements with those higher power systems. And of course, I think this will apply into the future as well when we start adoption of 800G systems as well. So thank you for your time. That's all I have today to introduce our solution for these applications. I want to say thank you to everyone who joined today, and like Stephen said, we will now try to answer as many questions as we can.
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much, Blake, and we are indeed in the Q&A portion of the proceedings. If you have a question, all you have to do is open the Q&A submission window. Click in it, type in your question, and hit the submission button and join the queue. Let's see, it looks like some people have done this already. Let's start with this question, Blake. I think you just mentioned a lot of what we're expecting to see at 400G is in the QSFP double D type of module. Someone here wants to know whether the solution you've talked about can also be used for other form factors like OSFP or CFP2.
Yeah, good question. Right now, Henkel has been focused on the QSFP form factor almost entirely, and that's mostly because, you know, if you think about back to this graph that I showed, QSFPD form factor, really has the highest bandwidth density out of all the legacy form factors that we've worked with. And so we really wanted to start with the challenging applications and proving out in our system that we can achieve the thermal performance and durability with the specific QSFPD form factor. I think in terms of business, it is our intention to expand everything widely across different module types. So certainly OSFP, CFP2 are things that we're considering. But right now, we are focused on launching our product with most of the empirical test data and performance data I have shared with you today focusing on QSFP-DD. But really the next step after we commercialize this solution in the coming month or two is to expand across different module types. And we don't see, in terms of anything technical, we don't really see a large limitation of coating our material onto different form factor heat sinks. Of course, there are exceptions. You know, there's a lot of different heatsink designs, a lot of different applications out there, and I think it's our goal to address as many of them as we can.
Very good. Again, if you've got a question, now's the time to ask it. Just type it into the Q&A submission window and hit the button, as this person did. The audience member states that in the analysis presented, what is the planarity and the roughness considered in the heatsink and module metal-to-metal contact surfaces?
Okay, so what we focused on is we really wanted to use the QSFP DD MSA specification as kind of a guiding principle. So we took the module itself, we took the flatness and roughness requirements from that MSA for the module, and we wanted to make sure that our requirements for coating on the heat sinks was somewhat similar. So we're within an order of magnitude of the MSA specification. Our requirements are a little bit more loose though, because we want to be able to accommodate various heat sinks, various heat sink designs, the material types. So the roughness that we require in terms of heat sinks, I think, is equal to or less than 3 micron RA, which is about 4 times the MSA limit. Again, trying to be accommodating there. And then in terms of ISO flatness, I believe the MSA specification for QSFP-DD is less than or equal to 50 micron flatness, and we will accept anything that's less than or equal to 75 microns flatness.
Very good. Let's see, next we have a few people who want some details on how you actually perform the coating. So for example, someone here wants to know whether they need to send you the heatsink or just provide
the definition
of the heatsink.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah, I can talk on that kind of at a high level. It's a proprietary process, so it will be a coating service that Henkel provides. So it's something that we will always be doing on our own manufacturing sites. So right now, what we've been doing with the heatsink vendors and working with our customers is having the heatsinks, the finished good heatsinks sent to us for coating, and then we ship to the customer. We're working on how we can improve the process flow for these coatings, and I think a lot of details are important here. So looking at the heatsink type, trying to minimize lead times, of course, is always something that we want to consider. But it, you know, what we can do in terms of coating the pedestal or the heatsink is really going to be dependent on the customer, the vendor, the requested lead times, the heatsink design itself. So we're really trying to enable the supply chain process of the vendors and the customers as much as we can, and we don't want to add lead time, but of course providing an extra service certainly does take some time, and we will certainly work with any vendor or customer on what's preferable and how we can minimize any impact that our service causes.
Again, if you've got a question, I've got a few more minutes, type it in the Q&A submission window and hit the submission button. Blake, someone in the audience points out that there's been a lot of discussion about applications greater than 14 watts. Someone wants to know how the material might help non-ZR type pluggable modules like QSFP-DD, QSFP, and OSFP for less than 14 watts.
Okay, yeah, so we've had a couple customers who've done early trials and testing at a lot lower power for their modules, and essentially that just, lowering the power lowers the overall delta T temperature improvement that you see typically. So we really, coating heat sinks for modules with lower than 14 or 15 watts, we still see that 0.33 degrees C per watt improvement, but because the power is so much lower, that translates again into a lower delta T. So you will certainly still see an improvement over the bare metal, but really this is more focused at high temperature reduction for high power systems. We think that there's still value there, certainly, and it should be worth it for customers who not only want a thermal improvement but are looking for an improvement in the interface durability and the long-term reliability of their module heatsink interface. So although the thermal is improvement, we, you know, it's good to remember that we're still bringing a little bit more in terms of the total solution than just the thermal performance at lower power.
Very good. Now here, someone wants to know what should be the thermal conductivity of the heatsink material for attaching with the chips, but I'm assuming it means, anyway, I won't assume what it means, basically. What is the question clear for you, Blake?
Can you repeat it, please?
It says, what should be the thermal conductivity of the heatsink material for attaching with the chips?
It sounds like you're talking about the module internals. I don't know if I can really comment on that right now. Obviously, the thermal interface material used in the module varies widely, and we have seen that lower performance gap pads or lower performance thermal pads that you're using inside of modules can have an impact, because essentially if those gap pads aren't very high quality or are very high thermal conductivity, that is the limiting factor in the heat transmission out of the module. So you're just not seeing as good of heat transfer within the module, and that obviously reflects on the ability for the microtim durable coating to transfer the heat from the case to the heatsink. So there is an effect there. That isn't something that we've really investigated a lot. But certainly there would be an effect.
Very good. Let's see. Someone here wants to know if using these materials, is it possible for the interface material to be damaged, or can it damage the connectors?
The interface material is a cured solid in its final form, so it doesn't really move around or delaminate or, I guess, gunk up connectors or really move around after we've coated and cured it. So the material stays in place, and really the only place that it should be is on that coated heatsink surface that's directly between the module and the pod. You will see a little bit of cosmetic wear on the coating surface if you're going to be aggressively inserting and pulling modules up to 500 times like I showed data for. You will see some visual inconsistencies over time with those insertions and pulls, but the important part is that we maintain our thermal performance improvement over those insertions and pulls. So it's really just a cosmetic thing and not really a performance effect. But in terms of the material being loose in there, we don't have really any concerns with that. And we haven't seen any concerns with contamination through the customer trials that we've done so far.
Very good. Let's see. I think we've got time for maybe one or two more questions. Starting with this one, as you alluded to, I think in the presentation a few times, this person notes that 400G ZR and ZR Plus modules are starting to become available, and they have a power rating of greater than 22 watts. What kind of delta T improvements over metal to metal can developers who are working on those expect to see?
So typically it's pretty easy to calculate that in terms of power. When we're measuring and we see the average of 0.33 degrees C per watt improvement over the metal to metal type interface, that's, like I said, was kind of across different heatsink types, different applications. So we're confident that that would be representative of someone using something greater than 22 or 21 watts. So really it's that 0.33 degrees C per watt times the power or watts of the module itself, and then you can expect to see the resultant delta T from that calculation. So that would be somewhere around 7.5 temperature improvement. We've seen in some system level tests with our customers up to 10 degrees C improvement. There are a lot of variables when you're doing a system level or application based test. The stack up tolerances, the heatsink size, you know, how fine tuned that system is in terms of the port and therefore the interface between the module and the heatsink. Is there a high level of variance? Is there not? So we're always thinking that the 0.33 times the wattage is kind of the average or baseline performance that you will see. But depending on the variables and your specific application, it could be higher or slightly lower than that.
Very good. And let's see, I think we have time for one more question. And it's a question wondering, have you characterized the impact of coatings on insertion and pull force, and what might be the impact on tolerance?
Yeah, so like I stated, the coating itself is very, very thin, so we're not really changing too much the pressure just from adding our coating to that interface, because it's very, very minor in terms of thickness. We do have a pull-apart test that we perform, but because we are focused on using the modules that we have been able to procure and obtain for thermal testing, we typically don't test like a module pull force on a real module. But again, this kind of comes back to both MSA standards for pull force and then customer specific standards, and we've been able to show that our pull force testing that we do on like an Instron or MTS mechanical tester is consistently under the requirements. So I think for QSFP TD is less than 50 newtons extraction force, and we've been able to show that our silicon material is soft enough and doesn't really have an interaction with the metal surfaces. It stays as the coating that we've applied and cured, so that we can have low extraction forces, and there's really no increase in extraction force than what you would see with the bare metal interface.
Very good. And with that, we've come to the end of our program today. If we didn't get a chance to answer your question just now, and I know that there were still a few in the queue, or perhaps you want to ask one offline, maybe you're watching this on demand, you can reach Blake in one of two ways. One is you can copy down the email address that you should see here on your screen, or perhaps more directly, you can click on the blue icon at the bottom of your screen. That's the one that has the envelope on it. That'll open up an email window, which has Blake's address in it, and you can use that to ask a question of Blake there. That includes a request for a copy of the slides that you've seen here today. Meanwhile, you also might want to take advantage of this final opportunity to download some of the ancillary material that Henkel has made available to complement what you've heard so far today. You'll find that in the Event Resources tab. That's the green icon down at the bottom of your screen. Just click on that to reveal the files, and you can download them from that point. As I mentioned at the start of the event, this session will be archived for future access, which should take place in about 24 hours or so. You'll receive an email with a link directly to the archive that you should feel free to pass around to friends and family. And of course, as I mentioned, the archive version of the webcast will also be accessible from our website, www.lightwaveonline.com. Again, look for the word webcast above the navigation bar. Click on that. Find this webcast at the top of the list of webcasts that you'll be presented with. Click on the title. You'll go to the landing page. Click on the registration button, and you'll be in. Now, if you're looking for a certificate of attendance, you'll find that under the yellow icon, which should have appeared at the bottom of your screen as well. Again, just click on that, and that'll reveal the certificate. Also, there will be a link to the certificate in that email I just mentioned. If for some reason either you don't see the yellow icon or you just want to deal with it later. Finally, I'd like to thank Blake for sharing his expertise, Henkel for their help in making today's event possible, and of course, you and our audience for attending. I hope you join us for our next Lightwave webcast, and please keep your eyes peeled for information on our upcoming high-speed networking virtual event that will begin September 21st. Until then, goodbye, and have a great rest of your week.